Before we get started, I'll fulfill my Hamlin policy obligations by saying that this event is sponsored by the Young Americans for Liberty of Hamlin University. I am its Vice President, Chris Wytovich. We also have the President, Billy Grant, right beside me. Give a warm welcome to our wonderful two guest speakers.
I'm going to let Chris do all the speaking today since I speak all the time.
He's a better speaker.
I'll actually warm him up just with my little elevator speech because people, they always ask you, why are you running? My answer is I'm running because I'm sick of sitting down, having my rights taken from me and your rights taken from you. And I'm trying to do something about it. That's why I'm involved. That's why I'm running. I believe individual rights need protecting from the collective. So that's why I'm running, to do everything I can to satisfy my conscience so that we don't live in statism. And as Chris gets into the points of our platform about legalizing and minimizing, which is on the cards that were handed out in front of you, happy to answer any questions or, you know, I'm like the color commentator today, throwing some jokes and facts. And Chris Dock is way smarter than I am, so hopefully if I get elected governor, I would get killed off right away and he could actually become governor.
That's not our official plan.
Yeah. Earmuffs, Keegan, you didn't hear that.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you to Billy and Chris for organizing this, and thanks to everybody for showing up today. We've got some familiar faces and some new faces, which is great. We're excited to talk on campus here, frankly, because your generation is going to be the ones that really have to fix everything that our generation and the generation before us has caused. So we apologize for what you're inheriting from us. But really, you know, none of the stuff that we're talking about can be done in a day. It's going to take a long time. We've been, you know, an official country for 240 years approximately. And what we're looking at is the gradual erosion of liberty over that time. So it's not going to take 240 days to return that in the other direction. So really, if you look at it, I mean, we're talking about decades of progress that need to be made going forward, and you guys are the ones that are going to have to lead that charge. So what we want to do today is, I don't want to stand here and tell you what I think liberty is. I want an interactive discussion, and you guys all, you know, participate and tell me what you think about what we're talking about and those types of things, because, again, we've got concepts, but most of it is to get government out of the way, put liberty in the hands of people, and you make your own decisions. And so part of that is, I want to know what your opinions are. Just a little bit of background on Chris and me. We're just regular people. We're not career politicians. Nobody who's running on the Libertarian Party platform nominations, none of us are career politicians, and none of us really intend to be. We're just regular people who see a lot of issues with the way that government works, with how government treats people, that they treat you like subjects, not citizens. Government's supposed to be there to work for you, not the other way around. And as was touched on with Chris's arrest, obviously, a lot of people get worse police treatment than Chris did. A lot of worse police brutality happens in the world. It was the middle of the day. We were in a park. We're two middle-aged white guys, and we saw a glimpse of what can happen. You know, when Chris was led away in handcuffs, you hear the police officer saying, "Stop resisting. Don't resist." He wasn't resisting at all. Once you've got your arms behind you and you're in handcuffs, you're going to walk awkwardly, so maybe he stumbled a little bit. I was impressed at how, you know, restrained Chris was. He was obviously in pain, but he did the right thing. I mean, he knew the officer was out of his, you know, out of line, but he didn't fight, he didn't kick, he didn't do anything. But as he was cranking on the handcuffs, he kept saying, "If you stop resisting, I'll stop hurting you." He wasn't resisting, but the police officer knows to say that because on camera, well, who's to say that Chris wasn't resisting 5 minutes before that? So.
And not to revisit the whole story, but you got to know your rights. Everyone, you have to know your rights. Just because the police tell you to do something doesn't mean you have to do it. He came up to me and said, "You can't be here in the park." I said, "Yes, I can." He said, "You can't be petitioning." "Yes, I can. That's free speech." He said, "You can't be filming me on your camera." "Yes, I can. The Supreme Court has ruled on that." He said, "You have to give me your ID." "No, I do not. I do not have to give you my ID if I've committed no crime or if I'm not driving." They don't like those answers, but they're the truth, they're my rights, which is why the charges were dropped within a day, because they knew they had no place. So know your rights, speak up for them, defend them.
Yeah, and one of the feedback, you know, Chris had interviews with media. One of the questions that was posed to him was, "Well, wouldn't it have been just easier to do what the police officer told you to do? Then none of this would have happened," which is true. In a lot of instances, You know, you wouldn't have, if you, we had just handed over our IDs, told them where our cars were, and then left, even though it was our right to be there, none of that would have happened. But you need to stand up, otherwise more rights will just be taken away from you. So.
And you would be on the ballot if you did that.
Yeah.
Correct. So how many people went to the debate this morning or saw the debate? Any general feedback on what you saw, if you don't mind sharing? Anything surprising happen? Did you see
any difference between the two candidates?
Nope.
I'm going to take your money, spend it this way. I'm going to take your money, spend it this way.
Did you see a champion for your liberty? Did you see somebody who was saying, I want to stand up and fight for the people of Minnesota? I want to return decision making to the people? Or did you hear people talking about how they envision government could work differently? You know, probably the most frightening thing I heard today was both Jeff Johnson and Mark Dayton said, it would be really nice if I were the governor and the House and the Senate were both filled with my party so that we can get our agenda done. That's scary. Because that's basically saying if it's a full Democrat agenda, then they can run wild with whatever they want to do, even if they only get 43% of the vote, let's say, which with the number of people that turn out to vote, maybe that's 30% of Minnesotans that are going to say, we want Mark Dayton, or 30% that say, we want Jeff Johnson. But if they can get clear run of everything, that means 100% of Minnesotans have to deal with what their agenda is. And that's just not right. So.
And that means 70% of Minnesotans want something else. They want someone else. We're just not the ones in power. The 30% are.
So one of the taglines for today's conversation was boiling the frog. Has anybody ever heard of that before? You heard that metaphor? So boiling the frog, and I don't suggest trying this out at home.
Get the bird people in there. They're going to get pissed off.
Basically, the thing is, if you want to boil a frog, how do you do it? Do you boil water up to... so it's boiling and then throw a frog in? No, you can't do that because he'll jump right out. You put a frog in lukewarm water and then slowly turn up the heat. And the gradual change is so slow, he'll never notice it. And by the time it gets to boiling and he's cooking, he never saw it coming. But it's kind of a metaphor for how government treats us. If you look at all of the regulations that are in place, all of the laws, all the taxes, all the things that are illegal, all the subsidies and credits that government has handed out to their supporters, if that all happened in one day, we would freak out. We would say, hey, where did this come from? There's no way we're going to stand for this. So they dole it out in small doses. So you might end up with a small tax. If you look at Social Security, for example, that was a tiny program when it was rolled out. Because back then, you know, if retirement started at 65, well, your life expectancy was still 66. So it was just this tiny little thing to say, when you retire, we just want to make sure that you're not homeless. And then it kept growing and growing and growing to now where people depend on it as part of their retirement income. But you look at the definition of what's included for taxation. I mean, right now, we pay 6.2% of our paychecks to go to Social Security. 1.45% goes to Medicare. So that's 7.65% of your paycheck that goes to that side. And oh, by the way, the employer is paying that side also. So it's 15.3%. I'm self-employed, so I get to pay both sides, which is awesome. So yeah, I get Social Security benefits, hopefully, by the time I retire. But I know that if I had 15.3% as a profit sharing bonus every year, I could build a pretty nice retirement for myself off of that. So that's just an example of something that started out small and now it's huge. And they talk about, well, Social Security is underfunded and is it going to be there? So what do? Well, we keep raising the taxes to fund Social Security, or we keep pushing out the retirement age, or we keep limiting benefits and those types of things. But it's this constant marginality of changes that, again, if they all happen at once, there's no way that people in this room would say, yep, I'll go for that. Income taxes. I pay more than half my salary in income taxes. That was a gradual thing also. And there's what can you do about it? I mean, I can't avoid it, so you just deal with it. But
well, and just to take on to that quick, that's a really interesting a question that I get often is, well, if libertarians have their way, all hell's going to break loose. There's not going to be any government, any roads, no health care. The incrementalism of change prevents that from happening overnight in the snap of a finger. So the legislature is still going to be controlled by the Democrats. I mean, there's still checks and balances. So when people throw that out, oh, you guys are so radical, you've got all these crazy ideas. You know, we're not a dictatorship. I mean, it feels like it, a bureaucrat dictatorship. But the legislature has as much power as any other branch right now. So it's a long haul. So don't let people be scared, like, oh my gosh, the lights are going to go out tomorrow if a libertarian gets in office. Like it too, maybe, but it's not going to happen that way.
So we're here today to talk about liberty. And again, I don't want to tell you what liberty is. Liberty means something different for every person. You should make the decision of what freedom means to you. To me, it's do whatever you want as long as you're not hurting another person. I can't tell you what's best for you, and I don't think you can tell me what's best for me. So we all make our own personal decisions, and that's how people live their lives. That's how government can work as well. If you look at liberty as kind of a liberty and freedom, along with it comes responsibility. So if you look at how we've progressed as people, from when the day you're born as you go through life, it's an innate human need to have freedom. I mean, just think of when you're born, you've got some freedom, but not really. I mean, somebody dresses you, somebody feeds you, somebody puts you down to go to sleep, somebody wakes you up, all those types of things. But you also don't have any responsibility. When you go to the bathroom, somebody cleans it up. As you get older, you get more liberty. So you become a teenager, you get a car, you get a job, you get money to go spend on your own thing. The car gets you freedom to go wherever you want. But with that comes responsibility. Be a responsible driver, all those types of things. You come to college, now you've got some more freedom. You can choose to go to class each day or not, and nobody's gonna turn you in for not going. There's no attendance requirement that says, hey, Chris wasn't in school today, I'm gonna call his parents. So now you have your own decisions to make of, am I gonna go to class today? How hard am I gonna try? What kind of grade do I wanna get? What am I trying to accomplish? So you've got more freedom, but you've got more responsibility too, because you have to make those decisions to get yourself doing what you need to do. And then you become, you know, an adult, you go work on your own, you get your own place, and all of that's great. There's a lot of freedom, but man, there's a lot of responsibility too. So those go hand in hand. Now, our government doesn't treat us that way. They don't think that we can make our best decisions. So we have some liberty, but they take a lot of it away. And they say, marijuana, well, that's bad for you. You shouldn't have it. Alcohol, well, we used to think it was bad. Now we think it's okay. You can have that. You can have cigarettes. You can have fast food. Marijuana is bad. Gay marriage in Minnesota, we finally got equality. But in a lot of the country, the government tells you who you can marry. We're not going to approve who you love and want to spend your life with. Well, what business is it of theirs?
Yep.
It's not. So there's individual liberties and there's collective liberties. And again, collectivism is a word that really scares me. Because collectivism basically means that you are now part of a bigger group and your individual freedoms aren't as important as the collective group's needs. So if you look at collective liberty, you can compare the United States to China and say that we have more freedom than they do. If you look at different analysis of countries' freedom, some say that we're about the number 12 most liberty-minded country in the world. We used to be number one. We used to be the beacon for liberty. And I don't want to be the beacon for liberty so we can brag about it, but that was what our country was founded on, was liberty. And again, over 238 years, that's going away step by step. If we don't turn that back and head in the right direction, it's just going to get worse. And America was founded on the principle of liberty against government overreach. We've all heard, you know, what we learned in school, taxation without representation, being ruled by people that are thousands of miles away, having your decisions put on you, what are you going to do for an economy, how do you live your lives, all those types of things, and how much money you're going to have to send back to the king in order to not have them come beat down your door and take you away. That's how we live now. That is how America works. We don't have a king, we've got a president. We've got a ruling class that's in place that doesn't really care what you think. And I know that sounds kind of harsh, but if you think you've got representation, you've got a representative, but they don't represent your needs. They represent lobbyist needs, corporate needs, whatever, big business, the unions, whoever's buying them into office, that's who they care about. So it's unfortunate, and I know that sounds kind of pessimistic, and I want to be optimistic today about where we can go and how much better we can get. Because we can do a lot better than this. We really can. In Minnesota, you know, we're the 47th best place for business out of 50 states. Why? Why not number one? And again, I don't want to be number one to brag about, hey, we're number one, aren't we great? Yeah, but why is 47th where we want to be? It just doesn't make sense to me. So.
Well, and you talk about, you know, he's not just throwing the stuff out. If you look, you can find examples of what he's talking about everywhere. Taxation without representation. Keegan over here running for state auditor is a champion against the Met Council. That's an unelected body imposing tax on everyone. What is Jeff Johnson's solution to that? Well, I'll put my people in charge of the Met Council to decide how to tax you and how to spend it. That's nearly $1 billion of your money for them to tell every municipality around here where the roads are going to go, where the buildings are going to go, the density, where how you can subdivide your lots. That's not that's not your representation. That's tyranny. When you talk about, what was the third point on there? Ah, just escaped me.
You're not hanging on my every
word. Sorry, I'll let you go back to it.
Well, and I was just saying, again, it's up to you to decide the liberty impacts.
Dragging people away. When he said, dragging people out of their houses, dragging them away. That's what the war on drugs basically gives the government the authority to use force against you. And it's failed. We jail more people in the United States than any other country in the world. We have the highest incarceration rate, nearly double that of China, who has four times the population. You think you're free, you're not free.
And again, I will say, as an option, as a person, sometimes it's okay to give up some liberty, and I'll use that as an example of, my wife is here in the back. Sorry to call you out here, hon. We got married a little over 5 years ago, and she's got two children who are now my stepchildren. They were 15 and 12 when we got married. And on that day that we went down to the courthouse and signed the paperwork to get married, I lost a lot of freedom that day. I did. I went from single guy doing whatever I want every minute of every day to married, two children to take care of, and that's optional, and that's fantastic. I willingly did it, gladly did it, it was the right thing to do. That's different than somebody coming to you and telling you, you've got to give up your liberty, you've got to do this, you've got to do what we tell you. Again, make your own decisions, take responsibility for it, and then, you know, live your life the best way that you see fit. So, how many of you
don't get married though, really?
did you adopt the children?
I did not.
They're not your responsibility.
They're my responsibility. I take full responsibility for them.
But not legally, because the father is responsible for
Right, them. But I live with them every day. I help them with their schoolwork. I help them make decisions.
But they have a father, though, right?
They do.
Okay.
Yep.
There are single dads out there to
yep.
do that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
So you're helping.
I am. Yeah, she does most of the work. Let's be honest. Come on. So the world's smallest political quiz. How many of you have heard of that? Show of hands. Anybody? It really is a small quiz. It's 10 questions, 5 on personal issues, 5 on economic issues. We've got copies of those if we want to pass them around.
Yeah.
So basically, it's 10 issues.
Everyone's got one.
And do you agree, maybe, or do you disagree? And I'm just going to run through it really quickly. Government should not censor speech, press, media, or the internet. I agree with that. Military service should be voluntary. There should be no draft. I fully agree with that. There should be no laws regarding sex between consenting adults. I agree with that. We should repeal laws prohibiting adult possession and use of drugs. I agree with that. There should be no national ID card. I agree with that. These are all pretty simple concepts. On the economic side, we should end corporate welfare. There should be no government handouts to businesses. Absolutely. We should end government barriers to international free trade. Yep, if you want to trade with somebody in another country, have at it. As long as it's not in, you know, something that's hurting another person by doing it, fine. Let people control their own retirement and privatize Social Security. And I know the word privatize Social Security scares people because they make it sound like we're going to hand money over to the hedge funds and the Wall Street people that have crashed our system and all those types of things. It just really means putting control back to the person of, if I want to put it in a 0.5% CD, great. If I want to put it in something that can maybe get bigger, I have that right. So I agree. Replace government welfare with private charity. Absolutely. Government charity is a misnomer. The people who are on government assistance, they're trapped into a certain level of life. And they just, it's not helpful. It's actually harmful to them. And, you know, we've gone and talked to people, you know, who are on government assistance. They don't want to be. They want to have the opportunity to make their own way, to have a job, to pay for themselves, to be free. Because when they're on government assistance, they've completely forfeited their liberty. Because now they are beholden to the government to do what the government tells them they have to do to continue receiving that. And then cut taxes and government spending by 50% or more, and I agree with that. And I know the number of 50%, again, is scary to people because we want to deal in incremental tiny little pieces. So if we get to 50%, maybe that's 1% at a time, and we go and we go and we go. We don't fall off the cliff right away. But if you look at all of the things that government does that it doesn't need to do, we've got plenty of money to fund government. We're just spending it in really stupid places. So again, I'm a big fan of the political quiz. Shockingly, I land on the top square in libertarian.
I'm going to tell a quick story.
Yep.
You know, when he talks about the redistribution of your money, basically the government trying to be compassionate with your money, taking it from you and giving it to other people. When I first started running with the Libertarian Party, I was in a Buffalo Wild Wings down the street there, the one that stinks. It was in the paper. Oh, the fumes and all the neighbors hate it and stuff like that. Anyways, so I'm in there and I was handing out literature and sitting at the bar next to a guy, and he says, "Well, you know, what do you believe in?" And I said, "Well, small government, you know, lack of corporate sponsorship and cronyism and stuff." And he's like, "Oh, that's all well and good until you get in. Then companies try to buy you and buy your vote to get you to do what they want done." And I said, "Oh, you mean kind of like what the government does now with poor people? They buy them by giving them food, shelter, phones, healthcare, to get them to keep voting for the same people." There's a guy on the other side of the bar, and he's actually a homeless guy. I see him all the time at the off-ramp, and he's like, "Damn, you're right. I never thought about that. That's exactly what they're doing to me." And it was just a really interesting discussion for his eyes to be open to what is really going on.
Yeah, but you changed his life that day.
Yes, sir.
He'll never think the same way again about government systems.
I got a question. I don't know if you know the answer, Keegan knows the answer. I haven't done the math yet, though, on it, so I was wondering if you guys already have. The United States has the highest corporate tax rate in the world, but then we turn around and give corporation tax breaks. If we were not to do that, okay, we could then lower the corporate tax rate. Any idea what that would then be? It wouldn't be, well, the world's highest.
The number that I've heard, and again, the figures are kind of wishy-washy because who knows how they're being reported and who's hiding what as far as how they account for things, but I've heard that if you took out, you basically put in a flat tax on corporations and said there's no subsidies, credits, exclusions, deductions, it would be 17% would be revenue neutral. Right now we're at about 35% for a federal tax rate, so you could cut it more than in half. And the nice thing about that would be there's corporations that pay zero because they've lobbied and bought off favors to get excluded.
Yeah, look at GE, zero. They paid zero tax.
Right. So when you talk about reducing or ending, you know, reductions in the corporate tax, people think that, well, you're just pro-business. No, we're talking about making a level playing field. So 17%, we'd have the same amount of revenue from that. But now I'm not picking you as a winner and you as a loser.
That wouldn't be the same. There would be more revenue because we'd have more corporations coming back to Minnesota.
Right. That's just an instantaneous flat.
Right.
And then exactly what you said, you know, if you look at the Laffer curve, you're going to build the progress for the future to have more revenue. And I don't think more revenue is the answer. I think then you have a declining tax rate.
Absolutely.
Because if the government gets more revenue, that just means that they're taking too much money from you. A government surplus means that they've taken too much money from the people. It doesn't mean they should go find new pet projects to spend it on.
So that needs to be part of the formula. When there is growth, we need to reduce revenue. Right? Somehow that's got to correlate with that and be part of the formula built in. Otherwise, you have the growth in government, and then you've got the quandary. Will they give it back to the people or not? So when you're writing these bills and laws, it needs to be that if there's too much growth, it comes back to the people automatically.
Well, and that's a great point, because here's the thing with budgets and deficits and surpluses. When there's a surplus, they find new projects to spend it on. When there's a deficit, they raise taxes to account for that. There's no floating reserve that says, hey, we've got a surplus, maybe we'll have a deficit. And again, I think we should just squish the whole thing way down. But they always go by what's happening today. So if I'm $10 in the hole today, give me 10 bucks. If I have 10 extra dollars tomorrow, I'm going to blow it. Even if I know the next day I need that $10. Because they can always just extract more.
Right.
So.
Yeah, if you got more players, then they owe less, then that would make more sense.
Right. The way to fund government is through robust growth for everybody. So, I mean, that's a good segue into what's the role of government and what's the difference between government and politicians and how do they treat you as citizens and voters? All they really want is your vote, let's be honest. That's what they want to provide to you is they want you in their party, they want you voting for them. And again, I look at government, there's different levels of government. I start with self-government. I govern myself every day on what I'm doing, on how I'm behaving. And then you've got your family. They have impact on how you govern yourself. And then community, state, federal. Now we're talking about global governments. It's really frightening. The farther you get away from self-government, the worse it's going to be. You've got the farther you get away from making your own decisions. Somebody in Washington doesn't know what's best for me. Somebody in St. Paul doesn't know what's best for me. I do. And as long as I'm not hurting somebody else, it's really none of their business what I do.
What are you talking about? Common Core is going to make everyone smarter, make everyone the same.
I agree with making everyone the same. That's one of the outcomes. I don't know that it's going to make everyone smarter. And if it were going to make everyone smarter, then it could be an option that's put out there. It wouldn't be a mandate that comes with federal ties to it, budget
ties.
Yeah,
in our case, we have to teach kids, we have to dumb them down to those federal tests for Common Core.
Well, Minnesota, I believe, came in sixth in the nation in how we do on standardized testing with a 41% failure rate. So it's nice to be sixth best, but we're just not one of the worst failing states, which isn't where we should be on education. So the other thing is elected officials aren't smarter than you. That's just a fact. If we get elected into office, we don't get a magic wand. We don't find some magic playbook. Hey.
Independence Party guests, come join us. Celebrities. Some food up here.
Thank you,
get
Chris.
Some grub, Brandon. Oh. So
government is often wrong, clearly. Look at the food pyramid. They've been telling us for how long how we should eat. It's a death sentence. Don't follow the food pyramid. It's not about carbohydrates and dairy. That's not the way to live your life, but I'll let you make your own choices about that. But I think that they came up with the food pyramid based on farm money.
Yeah. Rondo.
Look at the FDA approved drugs. So I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Dallas Buyers Club, but if you watch that movie, you'll get really frustrated with the government because at the beginning of the AIDS crisis, these people were looking for ways to treat themselves. And the government said, no, you can't have that. It might be dangerous. People who are dying of AIDS, they might have 6 months left to live, and they said, you cannot put that substance in your body because we don't approve it. We're studying the right things to do, and we'll get back to you. And we all know that FDA, I mean, it takes 7 to 10 years for a drug to get approved. So in the meantime, hundreds of thousands of people were going to die because there was no such thing as an approved drug. And oh, by the way, the first drug that came out that was approved was poison. It had too high of a dosage of a medicine that was good for you, but in the wrong dosage. So the FDA tells you what you can and can't take. I tell you what, if I had 6 months left to live, I would take whatever I could.
If your body, you can decide what to put in it.
If my child had 50 seizures a day and they needed marijuana to make that better, as Governor Dayton said, I'd go to the street and buy marijuana for my child. So. But why should I have to? Why should I have to do something?
That was the only good part of that debate, by the way. Dayton just admitted to smoking marijuana. That was the only good piece of info that came out of that whole debate.
You never inhaled.
Yeah.
Well, then he's really dumb.
No, but it's like I was hoping there would be a follow-up question, like, well, why then do you think no one else should be able to smoke marijuana?
Yeah. So how about the current thing with Ebola? And we're trying to get whipped up into a frenzy, and maybe it is a really problem. You know, maybe it's going to be the next plague. We don't know, but I've actually heard the government cry wolf so many times that I can't respond to them when they talk about Ebola. SARS, bird flu, swine flu. Wait a minute. Swine flu, the pork industry doesn't like that because people won't eat pork. Let's call it H1N1. All these types, killer bees were going to come invade us when I was a kid. Granted, that was 40 years ago, but I've heard so many scares that if Ebola is the thing that wipes us out, I'm not ever going to go believe it because I'm just immune to it. So, and you can't trust why they're saying the things that they say. And look at the ways that they lie to us. I mean, so Benghazi happens, and whatever your impression is of what happened in Benghazi, Susan Rice went out and said it was due to a video, an anti-Muslim video. They actually detained the maker of that video to help with the ruse that it wasn't terrorism. It wasn't a pre-planned attack. It was a spontaneous response to a video. Do you think we're idiots? Lois Lerner's hard drive crashed, and they can't get the emails that where she dictated the conservative targeting by the IRS. Try that if you get audited. Say, my records are gone, my hard drive crashed, I can't help you with your audit. It's not going to work very well. So let's talk about career politicians. Again, Chris and I aren't career politicians. Keegan Iverson, not a career politician. Heather Johnson, not a career politician. All of us running for office because we want to make things better. Not because we're looking for fame and fortune, glamour, anything like that. And I don't want to be a career politician. If we serve a term, that's fantastic. We're going to try and make things better and then go back to our real life and let the next person come in and do the same. So what's the priority of a career politician? Number one, to get elected. Number two, to get reelected. And how does that process work? Well, they're beholden to their party, because if you're a Republican, you need the Republican money to run your campaign, to get reelected, for the advertising, all those types of things. But what if you're a Republican and come out and say, I'm for gay marriage? Well, they drop you. They say, we're going to get somebody to plug into your place, because now you're not saying what we want you to say. So if you ever wonder why Republicans and Democrats all sound alike, it's because they need the money from their party, they need the support from their party, and they won't get it if they stray from the party line. It's one of the reasons that I'm attracted to the Libertarian Party is I can say whatever I want.
It's because we don't have any money.
If we had money, I still would not be beholden to you telling me what I could or couldn't say. So if you look at issues that are on the floor in Congress and Senate, just look in the first 20 votes that come in, you can predict the rest of it. You know, yes or no. Republican, Democrat. Once you have 20 votes in, you know how the vote's gonna turn out. So at a certain point, why even bother? They're interchangeable. And so if it's Jeff Johnson for governor, we went to the Republican primary debate.
One of them.
Yeah. One of them, yeah. Three of the four guys showed up for that. There would be no difference. It was like, whoever, pick one, draw numbers out of a hat.
Except Jeff Johnson said if Sunday beer sales were legal, he would get a nice Minnesota beer like Fat Tire.
Which is made in Colorado. So let's talk about money. I mean, we're talking about money. Money in the political process. In 2013, lobbyists spent $3.24 billion, and it wasn't an election year. So think about what's happening while we're not looking. There's a lot of money going through the system, and what's that buying? In 2012, the presidential election, they spent $2 billion on campaigns. 2012 congressional campaigns, $7 billion. 2014 Minnesota governor campaigns, Dayton got $500,000 in state funds. Johnson got $400,000. We didn't get anything. Hannah Nicollet didn't get anything. Chris Wright didn't get anything. I don't think any of us should get anything. I don't think the state should be handing us money. But their level of, to qualify for it, if you've raised a certain amount of money, we'll give you another big pile of money. And that's your money. That's your tax money. You've got nothing to say about that. Why is the government subsidizing elections?
You mean everybody in here has to pay for campaigns, left and right?
But at least you've helped both sides. Because there's only two options.
I'm not allowed to give anything to my party preference. Is that what you just said?
I mean, you can't give money to your party of preference.
But not the taxation.
If it wasn't already taken from you,
after the state gets it out to whoever they want.
We have to meet certain fundraising requirements. We have to meet fundraising requirements to get the big pile of money.
But they have a big general fund. And then the government themselves sets these thresholds for third parties that are almost impossible to get to. So, for example, like he said, of that general fund, $540,000 of your money went to Mark Dayton, who probably needs the money the most, let's be honest. $440,000 went to Jeff Johnson. Zero went to any of the other parties. So,
but I don't support any of those candidates, yet I had to support them financially by government mandate.
Yeah, basically.
Well, and now let's talk about the PCR program, where you can contribute $50 to a political party or a political campaign, and the government will reimburse you for that, $50 per taxpayer per year. So do we use that? Yes, we need it. We, for our small support base, we use that to say, if you give us $50, you'll get a rebate from the government. The whole program's ridiculous. I mean, that's millions of dollars. If every taxpayer in Minnesota actually took advantage of that, we're talking $100 million that would be on the table, and that's general funds that go back and just get reimbursed. So what's the point? If you want to contribute to a political party, go ahead, but why is the government basically subsidizing that? It doesn't make any sense, but who wrote the rules?
Yeah.
And just an example, so for this year's governor's campaign, the salary for governor is $110,000 a year. Your term is 4 years, so you make $440,000 in your term of governor. Mark Dayton's willing to spend $4 million to get that? It doesn't make sense. Why would you spend 10 times as much money to campaign to get a job? I mean, would you go, if you're looking for a job that pays $50,000, would you spend $500,000 on your resume? It doesn't make any sense. So what does that tell you what's behind the scenes? It's worth it to somebody. And just like Mark Dayton and Jeff Johnson both said, their dream is that they could be governor and have the House and the Senate be on their side so they can get their stuff done. That stuff scares me. The major parties control your options. Again, we saw the debate today. There were two people there, Jeff Johnson, Mark Dayton. Hannah Nicollet, who is part of a major party, not there. Because all major parties who are currently polling 10% or more. Let's just keep changing the bar until you can't get in, until it's two people we want. The Duluth debate, if the people who are sponsoring the Duluth debate have endorsed Jeff Johnson, well, why would they want Chris Holbrook there? Why would they want somebody who can speak against Jeff Johnson? It's controlled. And as a voter, you should be upset.
Why are
you have a range of options.
Endorsing candidates in the first place? Star Trip came out yesterday and endorsed Mark Dayton. Who do you think they're going to put on the front page every day? Sorry.
No, that's good. How does that distort the information that's being put to voters? And again, I'm not standing here saying I want everybody to vote for us. I want everybody.
I'll say it. I want everyone to vote for us.
I want people to be informed. Just be informed. We've got five options on the ballot for governor this year. All five deserve to be heard. We went through the process to get petitions to get us on that ballot. we've already jumped through the hoops to be a viable candidate. Why exclude us? If our ideas are bad, the voters will tell us. But the voters can't tell us if they don't know we exist. If we use the comparison, it's like Coke and Pepsi. Let's say that there's two options, Coke and Pepsi. Well, why isn't there RC Cola and Tab? And I know I'm going way back. Tab. These things probably don't exist anymore.
I'm saying, what about orange juice?
Yeah, water.
What about whiskey?
Whatever you want. But if there's 100 people voting, 51 people vote for Coke and 49 people vote for Pepsi, does that mean you all have to drink Coke? It's kind of the way our government works. Why even have that mandate? Why have that vote?
Are you going into ranked choice voting?
Later, but go ahead. No, yeah, I mean, there's no structure.
Because it's not 51 voting for Coke and 49 voting for Pepsi. You're getting 3 voting for Coke, 2.5 voting for Pepsi, and the other 4.5 want something else. Everyone's got to drink Coke.
Yeah, in 2010, when Mark Dayton won, he got 30% of eligible voters picked him. 30%. And now we all adhere to his agenda. Part of the problem is that not 100% of eligible voters voted. That's a problem. Part of it is that there aren't other options. But yeah, I mean, basically, the two parties want to keep it that way. 58% of people say that the DFL and the GOP do not represent their views. 58%. So that's where we get into the concept of voting for the lesser of two evils. So if you've got two options, I'm going to pick the one that I hate the least. The less. I'm sorry.
But they're both still an evil option. Rick, looking at you.
So, you know, Chris mentioned the media. Let's talk about that. Traditional media has loyalty to the major parties. I mean, it's a big business. They have collusion, let's just be honest. And that's not us screaming sour grapes. Again, it's not just us. It's the Independence Party. It's the Grassroots Party. It's the Unicorn Party. It's whatever is out there. If you have ideas that you want to put in front of the voters should decide what's valid and what's not. It shouldn't be pre. So you look at a poll.
That's right. Voters are being suppressed.
It's not just the debates, it's the polls. So if you're not included in a poll, how can you gauge whether anybody cares about what you're saying? I mean, it's a circular reference of you've got to be polling 10% to get in this debate, but they can't know about you if we don't tell them, and we own the Star Tribune, and we're not going to tell them about you. Heather?
Yeah, even the polls are manipulated, not just from exclusion from polls, but if you're excluded from debates in the media in general, no one will hear your message. Therefore, you will not poll accurately.
And then when they poll, they can manipulate the data, and if they say that they polled 1,000 people, then they can boil that down to who they consider to be likely voters. So I polled 1,000 people. I'm going to exclude 200 of them because I don't think they're really going to go to the poll. So I can skew the numbers, and that's valid statistically to present it that way. So, and, you know, like Chris said, newspapers endorse candidates. And if you look at what news is on the TV stations, MSNBC caters to liberals. Fox caters to conservatives. We all know that. My dad watches Fox because he wants Sean Hannity to reinforce what he feels that day about what's happening. Well, you know, what did Obama do today wrong? That's what he wants to hear. Where do you go for just straight talk news? There really isn't a mainstream option for it. And that's...
The internet, man.
Yeah.
And everything's true on the internet.
Non-traditional media is fantastic because it's not filtered, but it's also not necessarily validated. So it's up to each of you to figure out where to go for information that you can trust. We know a guy named Ben Swan. He's in about truth in media. If you go to benswan.com, he does a really good job of just cutting through the BS and reporting the truth. But that's my opinion. I'm telling you that you have to become a fan of Ben Swan.
Well, he actually, too, I don't know, any of you guys heard of RT America? RT TV? Yeah. That's basically a Russian-based co-op with people like Tyrell Ventura, and Ben Swan works for them now, too. There's sources like that that give you more honest reporting than Star Tribune and Duluth News.
How do you feel about the BBC?
The BBC? I don't know the media too well in Britain. Well, how do you feel about them?
I think it's a different perspective from Europe. I mean, at least off this continent. And that right there gives you a little bit of something.
BBC, I like the BBC. They've got their own reporters. Even Al Jazeera. I've watched them forever. And they've got their own reporters as well.
Yeah, they're not tied to political groups or backgrounds. Or more importantly, if you go up the ladder like the BBC, they have different bosses. So it's not one boss who's going to hire a specific frame of view or attitude that is going to force what he wants. So depending on what that product is, it could be all over the board. So in order for them to keep their job, I believe they've really got to stay neutral.
Well, they're not, you know, obviously England has multiple parties, you know. I love watching it when they're all in that room yelling, hey. But, you know, when I try to find data on, for example, national health care, how it has to be rationed for government to get the cost down, I get a lot of articles from England, from the Telegraph, from BBC, because you won't see them here. Here they have an agenda. They're championing the liberal cause. So I do think they're way more objective and great sources, and there's several of them. I'm sure you guys have other ones.
You know, one website that I think is interesting is isidewith.com, and basically you go out there and you answer questions about policies, and it doesn't say, here's what one candidate or party says about it. It's just, what do you think about abortion, taxation, foreign wars, the drug war, education, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And at the end, it says, for your local elections, here's who best aligns with your viewpoints. I just took it a couple days ago, and Chris Holbrook and I actually had said I should vote for us. Which was really a relief, because if it had said Mark Dayton, I would have been really conflicted. But it's a tool for voters to become educated about who aligns with their viewpoints. And Heather?
That site does not include all candidates, even though candidates have submitted their info.
Yep. So everything's got a downside, unfortunately.
Also, what I side with, too, is if you send in, as a candidate, which I did, send in your information, your questionnaire, and they don't report on it, they report what they believe the libertarian perspective is. So when I did isidewith.com, I sided with myself 88% of the time, according to them, and I thought that was kind of a unique statistic. And then, well, there is a little disclaimer, a little question mark or S sign that says, well, where did the source come from? Well, the source that they click, if you click on it, says, well, libertarians typically feel this way, so that's what they put down as my answer, without ever talking to me. So there's all kinds of stuff out there that that people have talked in my campaign about what I want to do, you know, that's just not true, you know, and that people don't if I don't have the media or the bully pulpit or the radio or the TV, you know, and all the money to go in there and refute those claims that are very wrong about what at least I'm trying to do in this election. I know these guys have had the same thing.
So as we talk through this, what should the role of government be? What do we want government to do and not do? Heather?
The government's role, if it's to be limited as this country is founded upon, would be to defend personal liberty and provide justice when those liberties are infringed. That's it.
Are you going to say something?
Serve us.
Yeah, very good. Next, absolutely. So let's talk in kind of our current society of what government does and doesn't do. So some of the things that it should do and is currently doing, or that we can say the government should be doing, is services that it's not feasible for the private sector to put it forward in our current environment. So the state's responsible for roads and bridges. Well, then they should be responsible for those roads and bridges, and they should be in very good shape. We're paying a lot of money for that. Public safety, police and fire, a conduit for education, but not a mandator of education. Clearly defined foreign policy and military for defense purposes only, not interventions. Government should allow for a playing field and then get out of the way. Government doesn't create jobs. It can prevent jobs from being created by getting in the way, and Gary Johnson said it really well when he was told as governor of New Mexico about how many hundreds of thousands of jobs he created, and he said, I didn't create a single job. I just created a field where people could go create jobs on their own, and that's what government needs to do, is facilitate, not mandate. And government needs to stop picking favorites, picking winners and losers, handing out largesse to their supporters. They should spend money on needs, not wants. And the items that we do leave to the government to do, they should do well. They should do them efficiently, not wastefully, and not poorly. I mean, if you've ever gotten a flat tire by hitting a pothole, I have. Well, how about all the money for roads and bridges?
But you got your money back for that. Remember?
No, I didn't.
Tell me the story.
Yeah, actually, so it's interesting. I was driving down First Avenue downtown Minneapolis, hit a crater of a pothole. Tore my tire up. It was 10 below. I get out. It's like, you've got to be kidding me. The guy behind me was a city worker, City Public Works. He said, you know, what happened? I said, I hit this pothole. He went back and looked at it. He said, oh, that's a failure of, they had done some work on a pipeline underneath the road and filled it, and because it was so cold, it failed. He said, that's entirely our fault. Here's my card. Here's the number to call, and they'll reimburse you for it. went through this process, went down to the city. They said, oh, yeah, here's all the paperwork you need to fill out. I gave them my receipt for the new tire, all that kind of stuff. Waited about 6 months, and they said it wasn't the city's fault. It was the contractor's fault. Here's the contractor's name that did the asphalt. Mm-hmm. Took all the paperwork over to the contractor, and they came back and said, nope, the city signed off on our work, so we're free and clear now. So, I mean, essentially, as I would have expected from the get-go, I paid for the flat tire myself. But they ran me through this whole process where I thought I was going to get reimbursed. So there's a process.
Why did you quit? Why don't you just keep going and keep going and keep going? A squeaky wheel's going to get oiled.
Yeah. And that's actually
destroyed.
This is an example of how government works, though. I mean,
they discourage you?
I think of myself as somebody who fights for things. And I was like, you know what? I've got a life to live. It's a tire. It was $200. I got to get back to work. I got to get back to paying my bills and cleaning my house and all that kind of, I don't clean my house. But you know, I mean, that's really what they rely on, is that you're busy with your own life and you can only fight for so long, and you're going to give up and go back to that. And then they win. And so, yeah, I failed in that instance to keep fighting.
The no people in government are incentivized to tell you no.
Okay.
So what are you going to do? You know?
Why was there a government worker standing by a pothole and the guy behind you, did he hand him a card?
Because it was 10 below.
The guy behind him, did he hand him a card as well?
Maybe everybody else was good enough to avoid that pothole. I don't know.
Well, that's right. I work for the city, and that's just the policy. So the water department worker tried to help you out, and you just got the runaround, like you're saying, and they're hoping you're going to disappear.
You know, I probably got the guy that gave me his card. He probably got slapped on the wrist for that. For what were you doing, encouraging this guy to call us? So let's talk about some issues. First of all, what should government not do? Spending on wants, light rail, biking stadium, a $90 million building for the state senators, campaign subsidies that we already talked about, sweetheart deals for private companies, municipal golf courses, taking private land from people to build nature trails, bad policies that prey on our emotions. So we talked about Common Core. If you fight against Common Core, the pushback is, well, you don't care about the education for our children. Yeah, we do care. We care a lot, and Common Core is terrible. The Patriot Act, well, after 9-1-1, everybody's freaked out. So what do? They take advantage of that. The Patriot Act comes in and says, government can watch everything you do because in the name of fighting terror, we're going to watch everything that everybody does, and we're going to determine if you're a threat or not. Yeah, go after the people that are a threat. Get a search warrant. Get a judge-signed warrant to go get data on somebody. Don't look at my emails and phone calls every day. And sadly enough, I talk to people, and they say, you know what? I've got nothing to hide. Neither do I. I've got nothing to hide in my house. I don't want the police coming through it every day whenever they feel like it to see if I do. That there's privacy, and there's a difference between I have nothing to hide and you can just rifle through my stuff every day. There's a difference. But they, again, so many people just say, I've got nothing to hide. I don't care if somebody looks at my emails. It's a right. And just like Chris said before, you could have handed over your ID. You didn't have to. And you fought for your right. And you got arrested and injured for it.
Right to party.
Other things, you know, intervene in all aspects of our life. They tell us about, you know, how we can spend our money, how we can educate our children, who we can marry, what you can do with a pregnancy, what drugs you can take, who you can have sex with. And how they can take your property to be an eminent domain. They can tell you what light bulb to use. They can tell you you can't have raw milk. They can tell you you can't collect rainwater. They can tell a kid that they can't sell lemonade on the side of the road if they don't have a permit. It's ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. And all of it is in the guise of public safety and protecting you. I think we can protect ourselves pretty well. That's just me. So what issues are on the agenda, you know, currently? Medical marijuana. Minnesota passed a law. It's so lame. I don't know how better to explain it. We're going to exclude soldiers that have post-traumatic stress disorder. Why? Doesn't that seem like somebody, if marijuana is going to calm them down and help them with their issues from serving our country, wouldn't we want to support that? No, let's exclude them. You know, people who are going to Oregon and Colorado for treatment and their treatments won't be covered July 1st or whatever the date is next year when our policy goes into effect. Why? So we're going to say you're going to have to keep going somewhere else to get it. We'll tell you exactly how you can be treated, how your doctor treats you. It's not between you and your doctor. It's us telling you what you can and can't do. Angela Brown, great story about that. I mean, it's a parent with a child with...
Great story.
No, a great example.
Yeah, great example. Brandon over here has organized a petition to help drop the charges. I don't know. Can you speak to where that's at?
So Angela Brown currently is going to be back in court on December 17th, I believe. The Lacbey Parle County Attorney's Office is still not dropping charges. 23 of us candidates. Heather, did you you were on the petition as well.
Yeah.
23 of us candidates from the grassroots, from the Libertarian, from the Independence Party, and we even had the only senator who didn't sign on to this ridiculous medical marijuana bill, which was, of course, one of my favorites, Brandon Peterson out of Andover. He signed on to it as well, saying that a couple of things, obviously. One, that these charges should be dropped immediately. And two, the patients had sent this out in unison saying that when they went and talked to Governor Mark Dayton down at his mansion, they said that he told them to get it off the street and that he would be there to protect them. And he's not there now. So where is the leadership? They're nowhere to be found. Angela Brown's gonna fight this, and she's got a wonderful lawyer, Michael Hughes. He's worked with a number of dispensaries out in Oregon, but I hear things right now that she can't treat her son. He has headaches so bad, the pressure in his skull is so terrible that he's tried to take his own life a number of times. And for people to walk up to her, or government officials to walk up to her and say, why don't you just wait until the program is up and running? That to me is an irresponsible, irrational government and irrational law. It's cruel and inhumane, absolutely. Yeah. And the fact that we have multiple parties willing to stand up for something like that, but nobody within the DFL or GOP, with the exception of a few, yeah, are willing to say this is wrong. Let's back off, because as of right now, if you can look down at the Lac Qui Parles County Attorney's Office, it's law enforcement making law, making rules, and them trying to squeeze the very last bits out of what is going to be a losing battle. You find one elected official who says that the war on drugs has been a success. I think the percentage is 6% of Americans right now think that it is. It's a complete waste of our tax money, and it's a complete waste of our efforts, because fraud, theft, and violent crime are a heck of a lot more important. And it's just like you're saying, what's the purpose and role of government?
Right, and as we talk about medical marijuana, you know who's really against it? Pharmaceutical companies.
Oh, absolutely.
They've got pills that can solve whatever you've got. And do you think they're putting any money through the system? I would guess so.
But they just stated that as a solution, though it didn't really state it as a solution. When we talk about coalition building, when we talk about the strength of numbers, when we talk about that 5%, if we don't unite the Independence Party, the Libertarian Party, if we don't come together in a coalition to try to see where we stand together, not on issues, but on principle and what's right and what's wrong, what's correct, we've got to change that. If we want a third party, we've got to create a third party out of all of us. A Tea Party, Green Party, whatever we want to call it. We've got to come together and have one percentage point out there that's like 20%. If we don't do that, we'll never have a good voice in these issues.
David?
Brandon Peterson, actually, you might be aware of this, but he reached out and says that he wants to strengthen third parties. So a lot of us in party leadership in November will go in front of the Senate and talk about how we can bring more parties to the table. He's going to try and pass a bill to do so. I told him nobody's going to vote for it, you know, because the Democrats and Republicans are in power.
First, we need a third party that's strong.
He thinks they are. The one thing that you brought up that they will say as a detriment to all of this is only rich people will be able to run if the government does not help by subsidizing, okay? And the argument against that isn't great. And I don't know if you guys thought that through. You got a couple of weeks, but that's going to be our main obstacle, is how do we overcome them saying that.
I don't think we're going to figure out anything in the next 2 weeks. You're exactly right. I mean, there's a way for us to come together, because we, Independence Party, Libertarian Party, Grassroots Party, Green Party, Constitution Party, we all believe that the establishment right now is not the best option for the people. People want to see more options. We have a lot of work to do to figure out how we can work together. I think today was a great example. I mean, there was three parties there speaking out, saying, hey, big government is excluding the voice of not just these parties, but the voice of people, voice of the 58% of people who want to hear something besides Republican and Democrat.
And I think this just add on, I mean, what this is all about is what's best for the citizens, what's best for the voters. It's not that, hey, we want to get libertarians in every corner of every federal building, every state building, and rule the world. It's what's best for the voters. I mean, give them choices, let them make educated choices, and why limit those? We touched on the drug war, talking about recreational drugs. The drug war, it's a failure. It just clearly is. It empowers gangs and cartels. It creates a violent culture. If you want to, it's a product that people obviously want. It's the same thing as alcohol prohibition in the 20s. There's no danger. You make it illegal, all of a sudden it's in the hands of gangs, it's in the mob, and there's machine gun fire in the streets, there's drug wars, there's knocking down your door, going in with a SWAT team, all those types of things. We're putting nonviolent people in prison for making a personal choice. We've spent more than $1 trillion as a nation on the drug war, and we're losing. It doesn't work. 19% of the people in Minnesota jails are there for drug-related crimes. So we take rapists and murderers and we let them out early because there's no room in the prison. But we're filling it up with people that aren't hurting anybody else. The incarceration rate of African Americans is 12 times that of white people in Minnesota. What does that tell you? Nationwide, we have 2.2 million Americans in jail, which is 5 times the global rate. So are we 5 times the troublemakers of the world population as a whole, or are we turning our citizens into criminals arbitrarily? Gay marriage, Minnesota's approved it, but nationally it's still a fight. Government has no business being involved in any marriage, whether you're gay or straight. We had to go pay a licensing fee when we got married. Why? Why do I have to pay $150 to the state to marry somebody? I can see going, I mean, obviously there's a lot of government programs where they want to know that we're married, so yep, I go down and say, I married Peg. And it's done. It's not your approval. You can't approve or deny it. So why is it even an issue? Let's talk about government schools. A high school diploma costs between $150,000 and $250,000 by the time you're done, depending on which school district you're in. And what does that get you? I mean, if you were going to invest $250,000 in education, what do you think when you get done with high school? Are you just completely ready to be in the workforce and you're ready to go? No, we keep watering down what a high school diploma means. And we say that, you know, 41% of people who graduate from high school need remedial help in math and English. We spent $250,000 on that kid. We had him in the system for 13 years. Why can't we succeed in teaching that kid? In the last 40 years, spending has increased 3 times in constant dollars, and we keep lowering the bar. So when government says we need more money, no, we've tripled the funding, and it's getting worse. Like I said before, Minnesota ranks 6th in standardized testing. That just means we're one of the least bad states in the country. Money's being spent on the system, not the students. So when we talk about $20,000 per year being spent in Minneapolis on the students, that's not getting to the kid in the classroom. That's in the system. That's the administration. If you look at the ratios of administrators to students, it's really getting skewed, and that's both within colleges and high schools. And again, government's answer is we need more money. And if you don't want to keep funding it, then you don't like children. We talked about Common Core. It's a disaster, but why do states implement it? Again, if it's a great thing, teachers will voluntarily adopt it. If it's the best practice of education, then yep, that's a better way to teach kids, and I'm going to do it. The federal government shoves it down your throat and says to the state, Minnesota could get up to $330 million in federal funding by implementing Common Core. And then once you take that first dollar, you're hooked, because now you have to do exactly what the federal government tells you. We're going to tell you how you teach math, what you teach in history, how you teach it, how you teach English, all those types of things. I mean, if I were a teacher, I would hate that, because where's my creativity? How can I work as each, I mean, if I looked at all of you as my class, you're probably going to learn differently than you are, but now I can't do that. I'm going to have to treat you all exactly the same. And you know what? It might work for 5 of you, and for the other 30, you're going to do worse than you would have. And as a teacher, I wouldn't be around in that system very long. So we talked about health care, the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, as we call Obamacare. All it does is reduce consumer options, and it puts design in the hands of bureaucrats. You talk about, you know, getting health care out to people. Obamacare isn't a health care initiative. It's an insurance initiative. It gives you coverage, insurance coverage. And they say it gives coverage to people who didn't have the option to get it before. Everybody's always been able to buy health insurance. It's just whether you choose to or not, or whether you can afford to or not. So if we want to call it subsidized insurance, then call it that. But it's not expanding health care out to 300 million Americans. And as we found out, it took insurance coverage away from a lot of people who already had it. When I first became self-employed, I had a catastrophic coverage policy. It was exactly what I needed. Anything over $2,500 was covered. The first $2,500 were mine to obligation. So if I went and got a physical, if I had a sprained ankle, I covered that. And made me very specific about which healthcare options I chose. So I wasn't saying go x-ray my entire body and see what's in there. You know, when you're paying for it, you make some pretty smart decisions. MNsure is just an unnecessary duplication of a failed federal exchange. And again, it's federal money being handed to the state and saying, here, go spend this. And as a state, we say, well, we'd be fools to pass that up. So we spent $165 million basically on a website that doesn't work. How is that good? And again, it was, if the federal government is going to hand you the money, why not spend it? Because it's a bad idea. It is a bad idea. And again, the pushback is, well, if we don't spend it, then Wisconsin will, or California will, or Texas will. So let's grab as much stuff from the federal government that they'll hand to us and then waste it. But that doesn't make it right. If you look at government health care, look at the VA. You had 47,000 veterans who were denied appointments. And then there was fraud to cover that up and say that, well, the patient called and canceled their own appointment, or they pushed it out and they rescheduled it, they didn't show. We don't have any statistics of how many of those people died because of that, but it obviously wasn't in their benefit. So if that's where we're headed for a healthcare system, I don't think that's a great thing. We heard Mark Dayton today say he hopes we end up as a single payer system. Single payer means government controls everything, and that's not the right direction. We've talked about taxation. You know, when Medtronic relocated to Ireland, there was an interview with Al Franken, and the interviewer said, well, what should we change in our tax code so this doesn't happen? The interviewer meant, how should we redesign our tax code so Medtronic doesn't want to leave? Al Franken's response was, we should redesign our tax code so they don't have the option to leave. It's exactly what he said. And the interviewer said, no, I meant, how can we make our tax code more business friendly? He said, no, shut the door down so they can't leave. That'd be like saying you can't move to South Dakota because you're just leaving to get away from Minnesota income tax. So we're going to lock down people and not let them go make a choice. When they say you can vote with your feet, now they're saying, no, you can't even do that either. Wars and interventions, you know, it's the same under Obama as it was under Bush. We've got a policy of attack, invade, occupy, and fail, and then do it again. And in the, we're saying that we're protecting ourselves, we're creating more enemies. We send a drone strike over and kill somebody, and we've got a nice phrase for that, collateral damage. That's the innocent people that we kill when we do that. Our collateral damage is their brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, fathers, mothers, friends. And imagine if a drone strike came in and it was supposed to get David. I don't know why they're after you, but they are. And it wipes out half this room. Do you think I would just say, well, they got David and that's what they wanted? No, I would focus on the fact that it took out half of my friends. And I would say, you know what, I hate you for doing that, and I'm going to come back at you 10 times as strong as I was going to before. Yes?
It's a recruitment tool for the same people we're trying to fight.
Yeah, absolutely. So right after that happened, you think they don't hand out a pamphlet and say, look what they just did to us? Why don't you come help us fight? I mean, there's a reason that people are willing to die to come after us, is because of what we've done within their societies. And we write it off by saying we're fighting the war on their soil, not ours, so it's better. But it's not. And we've got 250,000 soldiers stationed in 63 foreign countries. Why? It doesn't make sense. And then we've got miscellaneous issues, and these are smaller ones in the whole scheme of things, but fireworks, again. In the scheme of life, it's not that big of a deal that we can't have the cool fireworks in Minnesota, but it's just an example of, why does the government think that we don't know how to make our own best decisions? What's going to happen? I'm going to blow my hand off? I can go down to Home Depot and buy a chainsaw, and I have no idea how to use that. I'm going to cut my hand off. But they don't stop that. It's like, where's the decision making of what's safe and what's not? I think we can all make those decisions ourselves. And, you know, when we go to Wisconsin, yep, we go to Wisconsin and buy fireworks, and when we're in the parking lot, 90% of the cars have Minnesota license plates. So, again, you're not stopping a behavior. You're making it inconvenient. You're sending money somewhere else. It's probably more dangerous for me to drive to Wisconsin and get those fireworks than it is for me to light them. Sunday liquor, again, yeah. Not a huge deal, but why? Why just make it inconvenient on Sunday? If it's legal Monday through Saturday, what's magic about Sunday? It might be a historic thing, you know, tied to church, and we don't want people getting drunk and skipping church, but I can buy it on Saturday and get drunk and skip church on my own. Just because the store is open on Sunday doesn't mean I'm going to change my behavior. And again, it's just that nanny control, that control we know better. We know what's better for you. And I saw an interview, they were talking about Sunday liquor sales, and somebody said they were against it. It was just a guy on the street, and he's entitled to his opinion. I think 6 days is enough. Great, don't drink on Sunday. But that's your choice. Again, minor issues, but it's just so much of an example of how government is treating us like children. And these issues, they're only a symptom. I mean, the main problem is government overreach. So you can talk about issues all day. Government overreach is the problem with every one of them. And the big party candidates only want to talk about minor changes. And when you say Jeff Johnson comes in and says, I'm going to audit all the programs and see where there's wasteful spending. Well, what does that mean? Nobody's talking about changing the relationship between citizens and government. And that's what we need to have that discussion is, what's the role of a citizen? What's the role of government? And is it what it should be? I think it's really, really headed in the wrong direction. And that's kind of what we're you know, here to talk about. And we talked about, do people care? Do people have time to care? Like with my flat tire, I gave up. It was a pain. It just took too much time. And government relies on that. If they make it difficult to make changes, then you're going to give up. And we just can't give up. And that's, like I said at the top of this, Young Americans for Liberty, we're looking at you. You guys are going to want us to make these changes. So I'm a libertarian. And I'm not here to say everybody in this room should be a libertarian. We've got independents. We've probably got Republicans and Democrats. We might have Marxists, we might have anarchists. I don't care what you are. As long as you believe in making your own decisions, I support you in that. We believe in individualism versus collectivism. We believe in liberty, but with the responsibility that that comes with. I like being a libertarian because I don't have to memorize what my party's stance is on anything. I just approach every issue of, well, what's best for me? Do what's right for me, don't hurt another person. It's pretty easy. You can go issue to issue and have that. And so when you see career politicians say, well, I used to say I was against gay marriage because it wasn't the right time, and now I'm for it because it is the right time. I used to say I was against marijuana, but now it's politically safe for me to say I'm pro-marijuana. You either have a position or you don't. And otherwise, you're just, it's false. It's not timing, it's right and wrong, and what do you think? And don't change with what's safe to say. If you think marijuana should be legal, then don't say that behind closed doors, say it to everybody. What's the fear? Just be honest. Again, I believe in the Libertarian Party because of what it stands for, but I would vote for anybody from any party that had libertarian ideals. If you are going to push liberty and talk about individual liberty and freedom and less government and all those types of things, again, we've got candidates in the Libertarian Party that represent that. It doesn't mean that I want that it has to be a libertarian that makes that happen. If somebody from the Independence Party can push that, that's fantastic. Somebody from the Republican Party could be a true defender of liberty. Fantastic. Democrat Party? Yeah, but they don't, obviously, because of their party loyalties. I know we talked about a lot of things that are wrong. Kind of want to end this with some optimism of what we can do. We can end the war on drugs and release nonviolent offenders from prison. We can legalize gay marriage everywhere. We can stop foreign wars, occupation, and drone killing. We can end the militarization of police. They should protect and serve us. They should not be waging war against us and treating us like combatants. We can return educational choice to parents, not administrators. We can replace government welfare with private charity. We can repeal Obamacare and return healthcare decisions to patients and doctors, not bureaucrats and politicians. We can create a fair tax system and eliminate the IRS. We can eliminate the NSA and only obtain information on suspects when we have a judge-signed warrant. We can stop letting lobbyists buy favor. We can eliminate the culture of career politicians and their corporate cronies. And we can get the government out of the way and let people live their lives. So like I said at the top, Young Americans for Liberty, you guys are going to have to deal with all this stuff. There's a mess that's been created, and we're looking to you to go fix it. So energy crisis, water crisis, national debt, drug war, foreign wars, overtaxation, overspending, government overreach, immigration, global hatred of the United States, those are all your problems. Yes, sir.
One thing I really like about the Libertarian Party, I know I talked about this with you the first time I met you, Chris, that we actually are providing solutions, and the Independence Party and all our parties, that, you know, it's not just complaining about Obama or, you know, said Republican or Democrat. We're actually coming up with proactive solutions. And I think if we, as a, you know, generation, figure out how to actually do that, we'll make a lot of good steps, you know, turning the direction of our government back to a reasonable state.
Yeah, and as you saw, again, during the debate this morning, Mark Dayton likes to point at the Republicans and say, you guys are obstructionist, and that's, but they need that obstruction to point the finger as to why things aren't working. Yeah. And when they control each branch and things don't work, they've got no answer. So, you know, gridlock and stalemate and being on opposing sides is what they depend on with each other. And in the meantime, in the background, they're making a pile of money off of us. They really are. So if you get elected to Congress or U.S. Senate, I think your salary is $174,000 for life. So just get in for a term and you're good. How does that make sense? Where's that public service? It doesn't make any sense. So that's everything I had that I wanted to cover. Again, it's not about me. It's not about what I think about liberty. It's, I just want all of you to approach everything with an open mind and make up your own decisions and realize you don't have to be a Republican or a Democrat. And if you are and that's what you really believe, great. If you think something else, go find other people that believe other things and that there's a different way of approaching things. And two parties isn't the answer. Three parties probably isn't the answer. Seven parties is the right answer. No parties is the right answer. It's people doing, having more control over their own lives. And the less that government has control over us, the less it matters who's in office. So as they fight and fight and fight about who's going to be in office, if we take away most of the stuff that they can do to us, it doesn't matter. So it shouldn't really, you know, President of the United States used to be a figurehead. It was a national ambassador to other countries. Now he's the most powerful man in the world. Each of you should be powerful over your own lives, and that's it.